Hey guys, David Kwan here. So in this video, I'm going to be talking about the video game Batman Arkham City, which I played on the PS3. I played it quite a bit ago, and I wrote, have a script that I wrote about it, my thoughts on it, so I guess I'll just pretty much be reading off of this, so that it's, you know, it's easier for me. And this probably sounds better, and it's not me just mumbling and bumbling about a game. But yeah, this is what I've written about it. As far as sequels go, Batman Arkham City is a big one. Compare it to the prequel Batman Arkham Asylum, and you'll quickly find that everything about Arkham City is bigger and grander in scale. Before, you were investigating an asylum. Now you got what seems to be a big, like a whole city to explore. As the back of the box states, that's 5 times the size of Arkham Asylum. And that's not all, because along with the increase in size of the game's playground, everything else became more, too. More collectibles, more gadgets, more enemy types, more combo moves, more challenges, and more characters. Batman Arkham City certainly features a lot of characters. With DLC, there are even more playable characters, including Catwoman, Robin, and Nightwing, and they all have different costumes they can put on. Then there are the villains. Save for a few, it's like all the villains of the Batman universe are here. The game starts by introducing the Penguin, letting you beat the crap out of him, but soon, the prison city becomes open to explore, and you'll find that it's overrun with criminals and their masterminds. Expect to come across famous villains like Mr. Freeze and Two-Face, but also some obscure characters that only die-hard Batman fans would really be familiar with, which include the likes of Calendar Man, Mad Hatter, Hush, and Deadshot. None of these characters I wasn't familiar with because I don't know the Batman universe all that well, but they're here. This is a huge, big fan service. So basically, Arkham City is the ultimate Batman game. You really can't expect a bigger and better sequel than this. Well, in theory, I suppose you couldn't. But on the other hand, there are many times during my playthrough of the game where I felt frustrated and kind of wished I was playing the prequel, Batman Arkham Asylum, instead. To me, the thing that makes Arkham City so tedious at times, it's the same thing that makes it so much grander than its prequel, its open-world nature. I mean, yes, it's awesome to leap off a tall building, flap open Batman's cape, and glide, but at the same time, that's what you have to do anytime you need to go anywhere. A good number of side missions are about gliding around in Arkham City. The perfect example is the side mission called Call Killer, in which you have to track down Victor Zsasz's location by getting to a ringing payphone booth within the time limit. Also, because the middle restricted area of Arkham City is shaped like a bat, it is guarded by these tall fortress walls which you can't grapple or land onto, you'll find yourself having to go around this area many times. There is no denying that gliding around Arkham City, especially after you attain the grapple boost ability, gliding around can be really great fun, but it can also get tiresome having to glide so much. There are also a number of times I felt frustrated trying to figure out how to enter a building. The game uses different markers to tell you where to go next and how to get there. Early on in the game, I have to find Mr. Freeze, since he's going to be located in the coldest place of the city, I have this thermal device that displays increasing numbers in blue if I'm going in the right direction, and then it decreases the numbers in red if I'm heading the wrong way. Most times, there's a small indicator displaying how many meters I'm from my destination, which my movements will increase or decrease. Complemented with the map screen I can access anytime by pressing the select button, this system works fairly well. I don't really have an issue with how the game shows me where to go, but even so, there were so many times when I needed to enter like a building, and I would spend a good amount of time frustrated, just puzzled as to where the entrance was. It might be because of the traveling is done gliding high up in the skies and running on rooftops, while the entrances are usually at ground level. The few times in which I had no trouble starting a mission were when the entrances were in higher places, such as when I had to enter Joker's hideout by diving into a building's smokestacks. That was easy to find out and figure out how to do. Thinking back of all the entrances, they were designed kind of like puzzles. I suppose you can argue it's a clever way to make you use your newfound gadgets and abilities, but a lot of times it just felt unnecessary. For example, there are 2 times you have to enter the police station. Both times, the way you enter the building is different. The first time, you have to find a small gate and you fire an electric charge so that it opens the gate, just enough for you to slide under. The next time you have to enter the station, you have to go towards the back of the building that faces the coastal waters, and you grapple your way to the building's second floor back entrance, which I couldn't figure out for the longest time. It's bad enough most of these entrances are obscured by other taller buildings surrounding them, but for them to be hidden in such a manner is, I don't know, I don't think it's that great of a design. Figuring out how to get from here to there is fun when I'm already in a mission inside a building, but kind of frustrating when trying to start a mission. For a few side missions, the hardest part is actually figuring out where the fuck the entrances are. This is especially the case for a mission Heart of Ice, in which I have to find Mr. Freeze's wife. The map shows her to be held hostage in this factory building. The entrance door is blocked, and so there's no other ways in from the roofs or from the vents. So there is this interesting way you have to figure out how to get into it. It involves the use of a freeze grenade, you know. And once you figure that out, once you're inside the building, all you have to do is beat a couple of goons. And that's pretty much it. That's pretty much the side mission. So the hardest part about that mission is figuring out how to get inside the building. Once you're it, that's it. And Riddler side missions work pretty much the same way. Batman has to get to the location where Riddler's holding hostages. Yeah, but good luck trying to find the entrance. And then after you do, consider the mission pretty much accomplished. It just feels really weird that beginning a mission is much more work than actually doing the mission. Thankfully, the main story missions themselves are designed rather expertly. Once you enter the building and start the mission, it's like playing Arkham Asylum all over again, but with more gadgets to utilize. The pacing is similar, having you go through a couple of small rooms or corridors by having you figure out which gadgets to use, and then there's a large room filled with enemies with many opportunities to sneaky takedowns. Just as before, expect vents to crawl in, and you still have to repeatedly tap the X button to prop open the vent doors. Weak walls to use explosive gels on, and gargoyle statues to grapple onto. I'm still loving the pacing, although I'm a bit ambivalent about how much more attack-heavy the enemies have gotten. On the one hand, it's a fun challenge trying to stay undetected from enemies armed with shotguns, heartbeat sensors, and thermal goggles. Their guns can be countered once with a smoke grenade, making you practically invisible for a short time, and their goggles become moot once you gain a suit upgrade. But those sensors, the heartbeat sensor, they're a pain. See, about an hour or two into the game, most of the enemies start wearing these sensors that go haywire when a comrade of theirs gets knocked out. This means that once I do a silent takedown on someone, I have to quickly flee away the scene and stay undetected because groups of them are not going to come to investigate the body I just knocked out. This really breaks the flow of things. I love stealth games and I'm extremely patient with them, but having to wait until the group of enemies start separating, even I can start losing my patience. So, I mean, I understand when I knock out a guy pretty near another guy and they become suspicious, whatever, that makes sense. But I knock out this guy so silently and so away from the scene that, like, that should still make me, like, unseen. But instead, they have this heartbeat sensor. We're just like, oh my gosh, a comrade is down. We have to investigate the area every time. It's kind of annoying. But, you know, it's whatever. Perhaps the game would have been way too easy if enemies remained unaware, if one of them got knocked out quietly way off in the distance. I don't know, I can't say for certain if I would have preferred that. What I can say, though, is that, in a way, because of the way Arkham City is, a lot of those stealth arenas can be a little bit grating and annoying. And I might be wrong on this, but I think the goons in Arkham City are better armed than the ones in Arkham Asylum. It's been a long time since I last played Arkham Asylum, but I remember that even in the later parts of the game, there's still a number of areas which I could just drop into a group of enemies armed with only melee weapons and just start beating them up. Granted, there's still a lot of hand-to-hand combat involved in Arkham City, because you'll always encounter them in a hub world outside the buildings, but I felt that in later parts of the game, the main story levels are mostly guarded by goons with guns. That's probably why the moment that really stands out to me during the final acts of the game's story is when I had to fight a group of enemies, most of whom are armed with pipes, electrically charged batons, gas canisters, and riot shields. Well, I mean, two had assault rifles, but they didn't really use them once the fight started. It's that scene where, I don't know, I'll talk more about this in another video where I have spoilers. Anyway, speaking of hand-to-hand combat, it's pretty much the same system featured in Arkham Asylum, Batman finds himself surrounded by a mob, and one or two will try to attack, and that's when you can press the counter button and watch Batman block and dodge and flip around like a martial artist on acid. Second time around and controlling Batman do these crazy awesome moves still feels powerful and badass. On the first playthrough of the game, every time an enemy is about to do an attack, there appears these color squiggly lines above his head. The squiggly lines will be blue most of the time, but it's important to watch out for other colors because Arkham City features many different kinds of enemies. And they all must be taken out differently. The guy with the riot shield, for example, cannot be countered, and Batman can only hurt him by doing an aerial combo. Enemies with electrically charged batons have been featured in Arkham Asylum before, and same as last time, they can only be attacked from behind. There's this huge, ugly guy with a hammer that you need to stun using the remote charger device. Another huge guy with a sickle arm and he needs to be attacked by a cape stun combo. There's a good amount of variety, making combat feel pretty fresh and unique, at least in the beginning stages. Towards the end of the game, all enemy types will be grouped together and those kinds of fights will be pretty awful chores because it's just like, okay, I have to stun this guy, I have to do this combo on this guy, I have to use this device on this guy. It just kind of becomes a little bit annoying, and it's not the fun type of annoying in the later parts, but, you know, still fun combat. It's a really good system, and it makes sense why they, you know, didn't change too many. They just included more enemy types. And just as there are more enemy types, Arkham City also has a lot more boss fights. The side missions feature main villains, but even the main story levels themselves have a good amount of boss battles. I mean, they're all still kind of mediocre and repetitive, requiring you to roll around a lot, tap a shortcut button to use a gadget, and then do a beatdown, and do the same thing two more times. That's usually the case. And still, I think the boss fights in Arkham City are a really big improvement over the ones in Arkham Asylum. In Arkham Asylum, it was kind of just generic and repetitive a lot of times. The one fight that stood out in Arkham Asylum was Poison Ivy because of how different it felt. In Arkham City, the one boss fight that really stands out, and I honestly think is pretty much like the best boss fight in this generation of gaming, PS4 and Xbox 360 and the Wii, I think it's like the best boss fight in this generation. It's very creative, and it's against Mr. Freeze. There's that there. I can't really think of anything else, any other game that has such an incredible boss fight. Metal Gear Solid 4, I don't know, God of War 3, Demon's Souls, Dark Souls, probably. Those are pretty much the only games I can think of that has really boss fights in the level of this awesomeness. But it's weird though, because that boss fight, when I get to talking about spoilers in another video, there's a lot of things wrong there. But yeah, that's the game. Overall, except for a few moments in the game, Arkham City's story is really compelling and dark. It's really a dark story. Whereas Arkham Asylum begins with a triumph of Joker being captured, Arkham City is a total opposite. It begins with the defeat of Bruce Wayne himself, beaten and imprisoned, and his Batman identity no longer a secret to one of the main villains. And from there on, the story only gets more and more twisted, and Batman more and more beaten. By the end of the game, I wonder how Batman could still glide around, because there actually start to appear holes in his suit and his cape. I really enjoyed the story of Arkham Asylum, but with Arkham City, because of the whole vibe and direction of the narrative, I was actually so strongly driven by this urge to see more of what happens with Batman. This is one of those games I could not finish, just because the story is that compelling. That's not to say that the story of Arkham City is just amazing, but I just found it very driven. It may not win any awards in storytelling, and I'm pretty sure it doesn't deserve any, but it makes you care. And on top of the great gameplay and great graphics, that means so much. So, that's the game, that's what I want to say about Arkham City. It's actually a game I rented from Gamefly, so I unfortunately did not get to play any Catwoman sections, and that looked pretty interesting. I'm sure it's great fun, but I'm just left curious as to how it plays and how Catwoman's story ties into Batman's, if it does at all. So yeah, that's it. So in another video, I will get more into like the spoilerific details of Batman Arkham City and just kind of talk about, you know, just have a spoiler blog where I can just feel comfortable with talking about everything Batman Arkham City.